Welcome this afternoon on the third of our days. Today we get to reconvene with our marvelous tenor panel comprised of our lecturer, Philippe Descola, Adom Getachew, Timothy LeCain, and David Wengrow. Today is the time for a more informal conversation. First, this is the way it will go. I will ask each of the commentators to come up for about 10 to 15 minutes to speak. We'll then take a break either before or after Professor Descola gets to respond, and then we'll open it up to you, the human members of this Tanner assemblage, with a certain attentiveness to the non-humans in the room. And we will then have a more informal conversation.
Show a few slides, so maybe I will do this from here. Again, my thanks to the Tanner Lecture Committee, to Jane Fink, Professor Descola for the lectures and this opportunity. So in his lectures over the past 2 days, Professor Descola has traced the remarkable range of what he has called extra-modern collectives, where collectives are understood as assemblages of non-humans and humans. In my remarks for today, I'd like to consider the question of the assembling of humans and non-humans from a very different direction. And it will seem for most of it that I'll be taking us very far from the lectures, but I hope that these departures will prove fruitful. So before I get into it, I just want to start with maybe three initiating provocations that will frame the rest of my remarks. First, as I mentioned in my comments during the first lecture, the nature-culture divide has always produced a differentiation of humans in which some humans were cast as closer to nature and thus the world of animals. The human-non-human divide has always thus implicated the division of humanity itself. While this division maps on in various ways to the division of the moderns and the extra-modern communities who continue to resist and deflect the project of modernization, it is also a division that ensnares those David Scott, following Talal Asad, calls the conscripts of modernity. For Scott, non-Europeans were conscripted to Europe's modernity project, were, that is, coercively obligated to render themselves its objects and agents. It should be noted that from this perspective, even the difference of what has gone under the rubric of the extra modern over the last 2 days would have to be reconsidered. Insofar as those at the margins of modernity, of the modern modernity project, are, to quote Scott again, increasingly obliged to respond to and be managed by the categories of thought brought into play by European modernity. We see this in yesterday's lectures, for instance, as threats of extraction and agricultural expansion force communities to adopt a modern vision of territory as exclusive and spatially delimited. So I'll just leave this question of whether something like conscription would be the terms we might employ more widely. My second starting point, though, is that whether or not we apply this conception of conscription to the extra-modern collectives discussed in Professor Descola's work, we can think with the figures of what Scott has called the conscripts of modernity to examine another meaning of the extra-modern. That is, we might take the extra-modern to be not only those that sit at the boundaries of the modern world, resisting its totalizing logics, but those we might consider extra modern because they are excessively modern. Conscripted, they are not outside the terms of modernity, but their relation to it, their positioning as liminal figures within the project of modernity, provide a distinctive vantage point. The excessively modern, the hyper modern, reveal the logics and limits of modernity from within rather than from without. And it is in this way that I'd like to think about the aesthetic practices I'll discuss in a moment. Third and finally, I want to think with Professor Descola's phrase, body territory, from the second lecture. You will recall from the example of Amazonian communities he described yesterday that the territory is viewed as, quote, a large living body that feeds, reproduces, and weaves links with other bodies. When territory is understood in these ways, the extractive logics that threaten the Amazon are not simply territorial incursions, but bodily violations, as insofar as the territory is a living organism composed of material and spiritual relationships of humans and non-humans. In what follows, I'd like to think with the with this collapse of the body and territory by thinking of taking up the body itself as a kind of territory, or at least a spatialized site of assemblage. So I draw on these three provocations to consider what I hope will be a kind of analog to the cosmopolitical collectives to which Professor Descola has drawn our attention. I would like to suggest that perhaps the practices of the extra-modern world, understood as those as both those uncaptured by modernity and those that are overburdened by an excessive modernity, might be closer than we think. So I'll dive in now. And okay, so almost 9 years ago, the Ferguson police, Missouri police officer, Darren Wilson, shot and killed 18-year-old Michael Brown. Michael Brown's murder would ignite a wave of political unrest and mobilization to be repeated again in the summer of 2020, with the murder of George Floyd. After Brown's murder, a grand jury was called to investigate Wilson's use of force. In his testimony to the grand jury, justifying his actions as a matter of self-defense, Wilson described Brown as monstrous. When I grabbed him, the only way I can describe it is that I felt like a five-year-old holding on to Hulk Hogan, Wilson noted. Brown, according to Wilson, was so angry that he looked like a demon who grunted and was aggravated. As we know, Wilson was not indicted. For many, his depictions of Brown as both superhuman and non-human recalled an earlier moment of racialized police violence in the United States. In 1992, shortly after the police involved in the video recorded beating of Rodney King were acquitted, it was revealed that the Los Angeles Police Department used the unofficial term "no humans involved" to describe the murder and or bodily violation of people of color. In light of this revelation, the Jamaican literary theorist and philosopher Sylvia Winter penned an open letter denouncing how the distinction of the human non-human had subjected racialized communities to the, quote, genocidal effect of incarceration and elimination by ostensibly normal and everyday means. She indicted her colleagues in the human sciences for the ways their categories and frameworks had facilitated this very distinction. The bifurcation of the nature-culture, human-non-human, Winter argued, had transformed some into the sign of the, quote, lack of the human, the conceptual other, to that of the properly human. The question of the ways in which a nature-culture divide was implicated in practices of dehumanization has, of course, a much longer history beyond the question of police violence. And in traditions of Black political thought and practice, there have been various answers to this problem of dehumanization. What I'd like to highlight today is one strategy or response that refuses the reclamation of Black humanity in ways that rely on the bifurcation of nature, culture, human, non-human. Rather than decry and reject the association of Blackness with animality, it probes this connection to account for the permeability and plasticity of the human. And in doing so, it reconfigures the body as a terrain, maybe a territory, on which articulations of the human, non-human are assembled. So I'd like to briefly illustrate this possibility through the work of the contemporary artist Wengrow Musu. Wengrow Musu was born in Kenya and studying and practicing in New York since the 1990s. Muthu's practice spans a range of media, from sculpture, painting, collage, to film and performance. Her wide body of work, currently the subject of a major retrospective at the New Museum in New York, has consistently and creatively scrambled the nature-culture, human-non-human divide. Central to her intervention is the ways that she positions the human figure as a kind of exploratory site. So consider this 2002 piece, Intertwined. which represents two conjoined figures with both anthropomorphic and animal features. The intertwining refers both to the duality, animal and human, but also the ways that these two figures are not entirely separated, and they share a catch in their mouths. The hands on hip positioning and lean of the figure to the right, which recalls the posture of a model, suggests a repose that invites us to see this intertwining as calm and collaborative. The second figure, however, whose hand rests on this figure and face leans away, suggests perhaps a more conflictual and antagonistic relation. Is this figure pushing against or propping up? There is always an instability to Muthu's assemblages that reveal the violences from which her figures are constructed. For instance, does the spotting on the figure represent a form of self-adornment that recalls celestial bodies, or is it a discoloration that suggests disease? As Michael Veal has noted, the beings that Muthu imagines are survivors of all the violence and material and psychic toxins dumped upon their bodies and environs. In these ways, her figures embody an aesthetics of fractured assembly. Figures such as these from the 2004 work, Patrician's Curse, are decomposed and recomposed. Rather than intact and singular, they are constituted by other beings, both human and non-human. Wheels, heels, sculptural pedestals, and claws are both forms of embellishment and serve as the prosthetic extensions and connections of these figures. These prostheses serve as the collective links of the figure's composite constitution. They form and they extend the body. We might see these figures as embodiments of the practices of operators that Professor Descola has illuminated in his lectures. These figures are literally constituted by operators that conjoin and disjoin. Assembled from parts of human bodies, organic and inorganic matter, taking animal and human form, the body here is imagined as a collective that is composed out of ontological difference. Zakiya Iman Jackson has argued that Muthu's compositions draw on the natural sciences, especially marine biology, zoology, and botany, in ways that especially probe connections between the female body, femininity, and nature. Her collaged figures are, Jackson notes, distinct in the ways their conspicuous madeness and artificiality is both magnified and embraced. This is not simply a form of willed and willful self-making. That is, these figures do not reinforce a Promethean story in which we are sovereign agents who can compose and decompose ourselves out of the materials of human, non-human, and inorganic matter. Instead, in Jackson's readings, these are figures produced through mutation, understood as that radical alteration in the interstices of chance and design, a process that is not ours because it necessarily involves a degree of randomness, or in other words, mutation exploits the unpredictable and the limits of human control. The language of mutation might offer one way of thinking through the confrontation between the cosmopolitics of the extra-modern and the forces of modernization. In discussing the confrontation, for instance, between territory understood as a singular relationship between humans and non-humans, unfolding in a milieu and territory, and territory as a Westphalian claim of exclusive use, Professor Descola asked yesterday, at what point will the disappearance of some of the components of the body territory make its survival impossible? Perhaps we might think also about what kind of mutations are constituted in this unequal confrontation. What might emerge from the adaptation of certain techniques of Westphalian boundary making? What new assemblages emerge, and how might operators be reconfigured? This is neither to minimize the real violent destruction of the relations enacted through the living forest, nor to insist glibly on the resilience of life worlds. It is instead to probe how cosmopolitics mutate, reassemble, and reconstitute themselves, to ask about their transformation over time. ultimately, my wider purpose in this is to ask if we might think the cyborgian figures of Muthu's aesthetic practice as one instance of a practice of assemblage emanating from the extra, as in excessively modern, alongside the cosmopolitics of the extra modern, as in those at the margins of the modern. Thank you.
Professor LeCain, would you like to?
Okay, great. Thanks for your patience. Again, thank you all for coming and for the very generous treatment we've received here at Berkeley. So for my comment today, I wanted to build a bit on what I said yesterday, but turn a little bit more squarely to Professor Descola's idea of moving beyond the modernist concept of a solely human-generated society, and instead embrace what he is terming the collective. The idea that the essential traits of both humans and non-human groups emerge primarily from the ways in which these organisms interact with each other. And as he notes, one of the defining traits of modernist peoples, and I'm quoting here, is their inability to integrate non-humans into collectives or to see non-humans as political subjects acting in their own collectives. Given that, it also seems reasonable to wonder if this inability might well be at the root of many of our contemporary problems. And if so, viable solutions to these problems must then begin with developing new ways of incorporating the non-human into our contemporary human collectives. So yesterday I was sort of arguing that we could draw on some of the recent work of ethologists, biologists, et cetera, who have found these very human-like traits among animals. I thought Adam's illustrations sort of point towards that kind of concept. And I think too, she reminded me of Donna Haraway's idea of the cyborg as being all in this kind of lineage. That these would be useful ideas, they're certainly not identical to animist views, but nonetheless would have the good effect of increasing our appreciation of and respect for non-human animals, as well as our shared evolutionary roots. So that was kind of my argument yesterday. Today I want to consider how we could embracing that collective might also have the surprisingly salutary effect of decreasing our estimation of ourselves. So on the one hand, we're sort of raising other non-human animals and organisms up. Now let's consider how we might reduce our own status in our eyes. And somewhere in between, I wondered if we might find something that I'm calling a collective humanism. So to do this, I suspect we must expand beyond recognizing a manner of shared humanness with a small group of mammals and birds, or I was just reading this on the airplane over here. Oh, whoops. And again, so as I was saying, I was reading this on the plane, late, relatively recent edition of Science, where we're expanding that even to vertebrates like fish, who apparently can show empathetic behaviors. But we would also need to explore how the human collective emerges from our engagement with a much wider biotic and abiotic world, including organisms like bacteria, viruses that are radically different than humans, and even things that we typically think as inanimate, which is to say water, rocks, minerals, but also tools, buildings, machines, technologies. How can we incorporate those into our collectivities is one of the things I wanted to interrogate here. Now, if we do so, would we to imagine a much more modest and obviously less anthropocentric humanism, one that emphasizes what Gibson called the material affordances that help to create and sustain the human? To be sure, there's long been a careful and more circumspect version, more modest version of humanism, one that emphasizes our weaknesses. Yet humanism and the humanities have also often assumed that there was something uniquely special about their subjects of study. As the historian Daniel Lord Smale demonstrates, the roots of this run very deep. Humanists, at least in their iteration as historians, have long labored in the shadow of what Smale calls sacred history, a religiously rooted faith that we are creatures of mind, spirit, and soul, destined to reshape and transcend this merely material earth. Ironically, this anthropocentric neglect of the non-human also pervaded the modern capitalist system and its closely related consumerist culture. It's a cliche today to condemn the modern world for being too materialistic. Yet from the perspective of Professor Descola's collective, you could very well argue that we're the least genuinely materialist creatures to ever walk the planet. Indeed, our modernist capitalist system conspires to encourage an utter lack of care and respect for the things and organisms that we exploit, what we might think of as a bizarre new age of immaterialism. We throw things away almost as quickly as we buy them, showing little interest in where they have come from or where they will go, much less how they shape who we are as creatures. Likewise, with the notable exception of our domestic pets, few of us have any regular interactions with other intelligent social animals, like horses and cows, that had once been woven into the very fabric of everyday lives. In this new age of immaterialism, we largely ignore or tolerate the brutal mistreatment of billions of pigs, chicken, cattle that we consume, all in the name of saving a few dollars on our grocery bills. This is why I was so intrigued and heartened by Professor Descola's examples yesterday of what, by contrast, seemed to me to be far more deeply materialist peoples, these collectives. The Sasharuna, people of the Ecuadorian Amazon, for example, in their attempts to grapple with the depredations of climate change by creating the Kauska Sasha, the living forest, a domain, and here quoting Professor Descola, entirely composed of living beings and the communicative relationships that these beings maintain. Clearly, the Sasharuna don't think that they invent themselves alone. Rather, their essential nature emerges from, quote, the material and spiritual relationship that they weave with other beings that inhabit the living forest. Given this, I wonder if it would ever have occurred to the Sasharuna that they were in need of something akin to the humanities and humanism. Or to extend Professor Descola's earlier definition of modernists as societies incapable of incorporating the non-human, might a corollary be that only such a modernist society would develop something so strange as the humanities? So to pause there for a second, I do recognize all too well that the humanities are already under siege from a variety of different quarters. I earn my living as a humanist. I'm not in the least trying to speed their demise. Rather, it seems to me that Professor Descola's concept of the collective might help us to imagine a new manner of humanism that is both more capable and useful and resilient and better at able to resist the barbarians at the gate, as it were. You're not going to be surprised that once again, I am going to point to both the sciences and the humanities as a possible bridge and adjunct to what we might learn from the animist peoples that we've been hearing about. But you're all familiar, of course, with the idea of the microbiome. But what I find quite fascinating about this is that some scientists have argued that considering the microbiome, humans are best understood not as discrete subjects, but rather as akin to symbiotic superorganisms, something like a coral reef. More broadly, recent developments in the socio-ecological concept of human niche construction also challenge conventional modernist distinctions between the brain, the body, and the non-human environment. As the historian Edmund Russell argues, humans and non-humans alike build niches with other things and organisms, which then in turn serve to create, sustain, and define them, somewhat like the woven fabrics of animus life that Professor Descola describes. The evolutionary biologist, Kevin Lalanne, argues for what he calls an extended evolutionary synthesis that better incorporates niche construction, culture, and learned behaviors under the umbrella of evolution. In this framing, human culture emerges as we engage not only with biotic plants and animals, but also with volcanoes and rivers, and even cities and machines. And finally, I think, and most broadly, some philosophers of cognition, like Andy Clark, argue for what he calls an extended mind, suggesting that even our seemingly most abstracted ideas and thoughts are, and I'm quoting here, best understood as the activity of an essentially situated brain, a brain at home in its proper bodily, cultural, and environmental niche. Finally, these and other similar insights resonate with developments in a variety of different corners of the humanities. The one that I'm most familiar with, that I'll briefly mention, is the new materialism, which I think offers a set of theories and methods that are very different than the constructivist postmodernist views that dominated in the humanities over the last half century. While it is a somewhat ill-defined and contentious field, I would argue that it, at its core, the new materialism emphasizes the essential materiality of humans, not just in the well-understood sense that we are biological organisms embedded in complex ecologies, but also because our thoughts, ideas, and cultures emerge in significant part from our engagement with a vibrant material world, to use Jane Bennett's evocative term. Importantly, the new materialism doesn't seek to negate the postmodern insights into the power of narrative, but rather to deepen that analysis by recognizing how these emerge from and are reproduced in the non-human material environment, what I and others have termed a sort of deep culture. Which is all to say, I think there's an intriguing and hopefully useful resonance between these novel scientific and humanistic ideas and Professor Descola's concept of the collective. Indeed, that all these insights are emerging in our current historical moment might very well confirm the generative power of the non-human world that they seek to study. Consider that it's been 3 years since a virus, the smallest if perhaps not the most humble of organisms, nearly brought the planet to its knees, or that it's been several decades now since climate scientists demonstrated their addiction to a particular set of abiotic things, coal, oil, hydrocarbons, was leading us towards disaster. Yet despite these warnings, our sclerotic and self-obsessed ways of thinking seem to have left us ill-prepared to effectively grapple with them. But of course, to diagnose the malady is not to suggest a cure. And with a few minutes left to me, I wanted to briefly engage the critical question Professor Descola raised. What is to be done? What kind of cosmopolitics might emerge from more deeply embracing the collective nature of the human animal? I don't pretend to have the answers. I'm hoping that during our discussion day, Professor Descola might tell us more about how we might draw on animist insights to reshape modernity. In terms of the more modest goal of developing a new humanism, I'm encouraged that there are opportunities to build on rather than abandon earlier humanistic methods of analysis and critique. As already suggested, the utility of postmodernist constructivism can be strengthened by a more materially rooted deep culture approach. Or we might consider a very different and powerful intellectual tradition, perhaps a sort of extended Marxist synthesis, a dialectical new materialism now informed by the developing understanding of the creative power of the material world, ideas which scholars like Jason Moore, among others, have already begun to explore. So to conclude, I think Professor Descola's concept of the collective could indeed offer a powerful means of reimagining the nature of humanism and the humanities. Such a collective humanism would, I think, fully and gladly embrace the human removal from the ontological center of the cosmos, in favor of a deeper recognition of our essential evolutionary, material, and cognitive continuum with other organisms and things. For the many urban-dwelling technological humans, this would especially require a much deeper appreciation for abiotic things, interrogating the role of the buildings we live in, the cars we drive, and the goods we purchase, how they shape our collective. And here I was hoping Professor Descola might tell us more about the animist relation to artifacts like tools, weapons, and structures. What role do these non-living things play in their emergent collectivities? What role does the making and building of things play versus the modernist dependence on mass-produced consumer goods? Does that make any difference? Finally, I wanted to briefly share that we had an interesting convergence of worlds at dinner last night when we were joined unexpectedly by a friend of David's, the prominent computer scientist, Jaron Lanier, who just had a new piece in the New Yorker, if you happen to see it. And Jaron was a pioneer of virtual reality and computer technology, digital advancement. I thought it was intriguing that on one side of the table sat Professor Descola, who has taught us about this collective formed of humans and non-humans. On the other was Dr. Lanier, whose work points us towards a new age of virtual reality that would, one might think, seem to be the height of immateriality. The table was very noisy. I don't think there was a chance for Professor Descola and Dr. Lanier to talk. But in this aborning age of artificial intelligence, of chat GPTs, I did wonder what Professor Descola thought about our chances of recapturing a more materially engaged collectivity in this very fraught moment. Thanks very much. Sorry about the problem with the slides.
Professor Wengrow, do you want to?
Thanks again for having me over and for including me in these discussions. Thanks for tolerating the gate crashing of dinner yesterday. And I thought I'd just pick up more or less where I left off yesterday. I asked a bit unfairly, because it wasn't a direct focus of Philippe's talks, whether perhaps we've been over hasty in welcoming the archaeological discovery of ancient cosmopolities of magnificent scale below the canopy of the Amazon rainforest. And no doubt such findings should be welcomed as a kind of redemption, as Philippe put it, of this whole region from this state of nature and from the logic of naturalism that was imposed on it by settlers, thus denying its true historicity and reimagining it instead as a wild or uncultured landscape of resources without people, or with very few people, to be extracted or destroyed for profit. As it turns out, this also meant denying the co-agency of humans and non-humans in creating these very landscapes in the first place, which, as we've known now for some decades, turn out to be based quite often upon anthropogenic soils, the famous terra preta de indio, dark earths with carrying capacities well in excess of ordinary tropical soils. These are humanly produced soils which owe their fertility to the absorption of organic byproducts from everyday village life extending back over centuries or even millennia. It would surely be a tragic irony if the result of all these findings was simply to gain Amazonia a few extra rungs on the ladder of progress that leads to cities, state formation, and civilization in the Western sense, thereby placing them back in the logic of naturalism and the transition from nature to culture. I was wondering if one way around this dilemma might be to historicize and problematize the origins of naturalism itself as an ontological lens, which gained focus precisely through the encounters between Europeans and non-Europeans, including Native Americans, from the 15th century onwards. And this point, I should add, was already made at least 70 years ago by the French historian Paul Hazard in his seminal work, which in English is called The Crisis of the European Mind, 1680 to 1715. One of Philippe's very reasonable justifications for focusing his Tanner lectures on the topic of animism is that he knows it best. Following the same wonderfully instrumental logic, I will now shift ground at this point to a case study in the kind of historical exercise I'm talking about, which I explored in my book with David Graeber, The Dawn of Everything. And then I'll come back to more questions about Amazonia. Towards the end of that book, we talked about the ancient Native American city of Cahokia, which lies on the outskirts of the modern city of East St. Louis. About a year ago, I visited the site of Cahokia with a small group of friends and archaeologists and noticed something that I found striking. If you walk up to the top of Monk's Mound, which is a huge pyramid constructed of intricate layers of earth now covered in grass, and you look over towards East St. Louis, you feel like you're sort of looking in a mirror. You see something that looks very much like a mirror image of what you're standing on. But actually what you're looking at is the landfill from East St. Louis, where all the toxic crap and refuse gets dumped and accumulates, forming a sort of pyramid, similar dimensions to the ancient one that you're standing on. And it occurred to me that the two mounds could be regarded in some ways as the sort of physical culmination of two different, I don't know if they're ontological frameworks, but at least two different styles of life, which I don't know why, but the, you know, the word terraforming popped into my head. And of course, it's completely inappropriate because it's meant to refer to what goes on a foreign body, like another planet or a moon, what has to be done to a foreign planet in order to make it habitable for humans to live on. But actually, there are interpretations of Cahokia which suggest that the indigenous builders who raised up a city from the swamplands of the American bottom from roughly 1000 AD to the year 1350 thought about what they were doing in exactly those kinds of terms, the creation of a highly structured and celestially ordered cosmopolity out of black mud and water, substances connected to a chaotic underworld unfit for humans to dwell in. As for the modern landfill of East St. Louis, I guess that could also be thought of as a kind of internal terraforming, or maybe terraforming in reverse, rendering large parts of the landscape permanently uninhabitable for human life, or indeed for almost any form of life, in order to sustain a city made up of human beings who have effectively, in practice, renounced the earth they live on as a long-term partner in the business of making a living. I'm not having a go particularly at the people of East St. Louis. You'd be talking about any city you like, more or less. We might be tempted then to idealize Cahokia somewhat as a sustainable alternative to the naturalist and extractive logic of the modern city. But in truth, the Monk's Mound was not just a cosmological pivot of the four quarters, but also a kind of surveillance platform from which it is thought that ancient Mississippian elites achieved a remarkable degree of control over their subjects, who probably numbered in the tens of thousands. According to archaeological reconstructions, or at least some of them, a calculated effort was made to resettle foreign populations in newly designed thatch houses arranged in neighborhoods around smaller plazas and earthen pyramids. From the summit of Monk's Mound, the city's ruling elite enjoyed powers of surveillance over these planned residential zones, and at the same time, existing villages and hamlets in Cahokia's hinterland were disbanded and the rural population dispersed, scattered in homesteads of just one or two families. What's so striking about this pattern is its suggestion of an almost complete dismantling of any self-governing communities outside the city. For those who fell within its orbit, it seems there was nothing much left between domestic life, lived under constant surveillance from above, and the awesome spectacle of the city itself, which included the performance of human sacrifices, mass executions, often of young women, and their burials carried out in public. Moreover, the influence of the Cahokian cosmopolity extended far beyond that part of the Mississippi Basin called the American Bottom, arguably almost as far north as the Great Lakes region. During the 11th and 12th centuries, Mississippian sites with links of various kinds to Cahokia appear everywhere from Virginia to Minnesota, often in aggressive conflict, it seems, with their neighbors. Now, whatever Cahokia represented in the eyes of those under its sway, it seems to have ended up being overwhelmingly rejected by the vast majority of its people. For hundreds of years after its demise in the late 14th century, the site where the city once stood and hundreds of miles of river valleys around it lay entirely devoid of human habitation, a vacant quarter, a bit like the forbidden zone of Pierre Boulle's Planet of the Apes, place of ruins, bitter memories. Charles Dickens actually visited the place and described it, I quote, as an unbroken slough of black mud and water. In The Dawn of Everything, David Graeber and I argued that it was precisely the rejection of the Cahokian cosmopolity, including the forms of esoteric knowledge expressed in its calendrical monuments, that laid foundations for the kinds of societies eventually encountered by European invaders a couple of centuries later in the territories that anthropologists refer to as the Eastern Woodlands. These were indigenous societies that long before the arrival of Europeans had moved away, disobeyed, and reorganized themselves into political orders of an entirely different kind. Small towns about the size of a typical Greek polis, a few hundred people with egalitarian clan structures, communal council houses, women's freedoms, as well as highly sophisticated cultures of consensus decision-making and participatory democracy that were obviously a complete anathema to the Jesuit missionaries who sought their conversion. How are you going to explain the Ten Commandments to people who don't give each other commands, or don't obey them anyway? I'm not going to go into it here, but a key argument of our book is that the very notion of human politics as originating in a state of nature, whether it's a Hobbesian one or a Rousseauian type, was established in European thought, at least partly, through the shock of such encounters. And to quote Paul Hazard, the crisis of the European mind, a mind long wedded to hierarchy, patriarchy, and revealed religion, that were precipitated by such encounters and by the indigenous critiques of European civilization that they generated. What we refer to in the book as indigenous critique, like those frequently reported in the Jesuit relations, are obviously not world views. But neither, I think, are they expressions of rival ontological frameworks of the kind explored by Philippe in these lectures. I suggest they may be better regarded as intellectual weapons of choice. Weapons of choice selected by indigenous thinkers and commentators to repel a very specific ideological threat, which at that time I think was really not naturalism, but rather a sort of imperialistic form of Christian analogism. In Europe, the result was, among many other things, obviously the creation of a huge intellectual apparatus, which we've now come to know as the Age of Enlightenment, having largely purified it of all the cultural cross-currents and indigenous critiques and mestizo logics, as Jean-Luc Pamsel calls them, that undoubtedly were a key part of its making. This is getting complicated. So I want to finish with a question or two to Philippe. Do you think we might one day, maybe quite soon, be able to begin reconstructing a similar kind of deep history for Amazonia, which brings together the evidence of archaeology, anthropology, and colonial encounters, and contemporary forms of critique into something like a unified framework, which also allows us to better understand the intellectual roots both of naturalism and perhaps even of animism in its modern forms? And then another question just occurred to me, and I'm sorry, Philippe, if you've answered this a thousand times in other places and it's just my ignorance or forgetfulness, but is there a basic difference or inconsistency among the four modes of identification, animism, totemism, analogism, and naturalism, insofar as only the latter has a traceable history and point of origin? As implied, I guess, by the overarching binary distinction that we're all using between moderns and extra moderns. And if so, then why is that? In other words, why isn't there more naturalism in human history? That's all. Thank you.
Would it be okay to respond afterwards? Would it be okay to respond afterwards?
Sorry?
We'll take a break and then you'll respond.
Okay, fine.
Let's take a brief break, 5 to 10 minutes, and then gather again, first for a response and then for a conversation. Okay, let's resume. So the procedure from here is Philippe Descola will respond for about 15 to 20 minutes, and then we will open it up to you, and then the doors will open, and there'll be a feast or of sorts, and we invite you to participate.
Well, thanks again to the TANA committee, to all those who made this series of meeting possible, Jane Fink in particular, and the members of the TANA committee, the commentators, and the University of Berkeley. Thank you in particular for your very thoughtful comments. I won't be able to answer either the straightforward question that some of you have asked, or even the hidden questions. But I'll try to say a few things about your comments. I'll follow the order of the presentations. I want to thank Adom for bringing into the topic the work of Wangeshi Mutu, which has, in fact, interested me for a while. And I will try to explain why. She, in a book I published in 2021 called Les Formes du Visible, The Forms of the Visible, which is being translated now into English, I developed, among other ideas, the hypothesis that image makers, and this term is broad enough to cover any form of making images, that is artists, but also cave painters or whatever, not to use precisely a naturalist definition of what image making is, that image makers, in a way, are prefigure transformations into the forms of worlding. And this has appeared to me very clearly when looking at the images of the beginning of the 15th century in Europe, where long before naturalism was expressed in words, in texts, in the 17th century by Descartes, by Galileo, by Bacon, etc., image makers, 2 centuries before, already presented in a very distinct form the basics of what is naturalism, that is the centrality of human interiority, subjectivity, by the painting of the soul, which already in the work of people like Robert Campin at the beginning of the 15th century attains a mastery which is very impressive, and the description of nature or the invention of nature as a figurative representation, or based on the emulation of human vision, which is a very specific way of figuring beings and things and scenes, because it's based, as Panofsky has shown quite well, on the imposition of a subjective point of view in order to reach an objective definition on what is an organization of the world structured by mathematical laws. And but even beyond the invention of perspective, which is the objective, the topic of Panofsky's analysis of this objectification of a subjective point of view, in the northern paintings, in Flanders, in northern France, etc., painters precisely like, again, Robert Campin, and of course later on Van Eyck, organized the world in such a way as to prefigure what is a natural system. So in that respect, we can see in the images the future accomplishment of naturalism, which will be again thematized in text, in discourse, only two centuries after that. But in the same way that the image makers prefigured naturalism in images, they prefigured something that we can't really completely grasp now, which is an overcome of naturalism in a direction which is still very difficult to figure. And this is why I became interested in a number of painters or image makers, among them Wangeshi Mutu precisely, because as you very well explained, what she produces are forms of hybrids that are very difficult to pinpoint. They do not belong to a specific figurative regime that could be called naturalist. And there are a number of image makers of that kind. I'm thinking of a French artist by the name of Pierre Huyghe, who is also extremely interesting because he realizes installations that are a combination of nature and culture in many respects. They are artifacts, they are he uses sculpture, bees, a very peculiar mechanism which selects images out of the development of a sequence of cancer cells, for instance. So it's it cannot be pinpointed either to nature or to culture or to any academic canon. And these attempts by image makers precisely allow us to grope in the dark towards new forms of worlding that are taking place now. And Wangeshi Mutu is one of these image makers, and I'm very glad that you mentioned it. Also, I want to come back to your initial point That is the fact that naturalism is also a means to scale people on the nature-culture axis. This is a point that was well made by someone I mentioned yesterday, Jacques Rancière, when he very clearly shows that there's a squirrel pursuing a magpie. So it's interesting. We have a further audience now here. when Rancière shows that in fact nature culture is not on it's a dichotomy, but it's also a scale that people who are occupy different places on this scale, and of course non-modern or indigenous people, women, workers are near nature, while are thought of as near nature, while white Europeans, landowners, etc., are on the cultural on the cultural side of the hierarchy. So this is indeed a thing which has been going on for quite a while, and the dissolution or the transformation of naturalism appears as an important objective in order to go beyond these forms of discrimination and value judgments that are a part of naturalism. There's a moral dimension to naturalism and political dimension to naturalism, which, as you mentioned in the specific case you brought, which causes much, which has been, terribly violent. So yes, looking towards images for finding new operators, I think is an interesting project. Now I'll turn to the idea of becoming more materialists, which I find interesting. I completely agree that in the sciences, the natural sciences, as we in particular geology, ecology, ethology, have completely transformed the way that we see this set of affordances that were thought for a long time to be a limited set, and opening up the picture towards things that are more complex, like human niche construction. I'll go back to human niche construction about the Amazon precisely, because that's a very good case of human niche construction, in the sense that all living organisms construct their niche, which they transfer to their descendants in a way. So, and humans are not different in that respect, which means, and it's a very, it's an important point for me, because when I started, when I went to Amazonia for fieldwork, my idea was to try to understand the forms of adaptation and socialization by a society of its an environment. And what I figured out after fieldwork is that it was a completely misconceptualized objective to begin with, because it implied the idea that society is a closed form that is as parachute into an environment. Well, it became obvious, and I'll come back to that later, that this environment had been patiently constructed, although not necessarily in an intentional form, but over the millennia. So the question of adaptation is one of the. There's a paradox here because I'm wary of this concept of adaptation because of its automatism, but at the same time, we are facing with climate change and with the broad ecological destruction and devastation of the Earth, a situation where we have to adapt precisely. So at the same time that I understand that adaptation is not an ideal concept and has to be criticized, at the same time we have to bring in or to activate it in a different way, because it implies our survival as a species, in dark circumstances. But it's true that emphasizing human niche construction or emphasizing the part of the microbiote in humans is a very interesting way of dissolving the dichotomy of human and non-human. What part of us is really human when we think of the kind of assemblage of which we are made, and what part of us in fact fosters the ideas that we use in order to understand the world, are the trillions of bacteria that we shelter part of this process and part of our subjectivity, probably in ways that we still don't know very well. So I think this materialism, this form of materialism, is extremely important. What is to be done? Oh, knowledge. in a place like here, it's obvious, no? At the same time, although, as I said, I'm politically involved in movements that try to claim a new use of the land, social scientists as such are ill-prepared to prescribe solutions. What they can do is point out solutions, like David did, point out solutions that people have invented at some time, like in Cahokia, for instance, do away with forms of political organization that were considered and as inegalitarian, and from these experiences, as you do in the book with David Graeber, try to imagine alternative ways of being in the world. And so the question, I don't think the question can be transposed as Timothy as asked, how can we learn how to deal with artifacts from an animist point of view? I think we are all able to make animist inferences. And in certain circumstances, when we speak to a cat or to a rose tree, or to when we are furious against our computer, as I am right now, because it doesn't work. We tend to impute an intentionality. In the case of artifacts, very often a malevolent intentionality to artifacts. It doesn't mean that we are animist. It means that the basic kind of inference that is the staple type of inference for animism is present in every one of us, but we don't stabilize it in an animist system in a way. So, to answer the question ethnographically, artifacts are imbued with life, more or less, in animist systems. No, a blowgun, a sledge, for instance, cases like that. They go against their owner. In some circumstances when they feel they've been mistreated. And of course, it's part of the idea that the artifacts have a very close relationship with the person, the human, who uses them. And so that's one of the reasons why people are buried with their artifacts precisely, because no one else could use them. No one else could use the spear or the shotgun or whatever, or the knife or the machete that one uses, because they would not accept to be manipulated by anyone else than the person who was their owner or tamer, perhaps, since they are imbued with life. And it's... among the Achua, for instance, if you lend someone an artifact and you are you can't refuse someone asking for something in many collectives, no, especially those that are governed by the gift by sharing. And so, if an Achua asks you, "Will you lend me your axe?" and that you do it, but internally grumbling because you need it also, the result will be that the person using the axe will experience an ache, for instance. No, they will suffer from using this because the axe transmits the. The lack of the mixed attitude of the person who lended it. So it's and all this has disappeared with the mercantilization of things and the fetishism of commodity. Is there a way to get back to this? That would be interesting. We don't know if we have to eliminate commodity fetishism first to do that, or whether this will eliminate commodity fetishism. That's an interesting, and that's why I'm interested in the what people do in places like the ZAD de Notre-Dame-des-Landes, because there's an attitude towards artifacts precisely, which is a very different from the one we're used to, in the sense that they circulate among people. And they have a certain kind of autonomy. Finally, I'm glad you brought the question of Amazonia. It's not only a terra preta, as you mentioned, that is the fact that the soils there are mostly, in many places, anthropogenic for the the biome, the ecosystem has been profoundly transformed, but also there is a process which I observed among the Achua, which is the fact that slash and burn cultivation means not only planting in gardens crops that have been domesticated over the millennia, and there are many of them. In a Achua garden, there's about 50 different species of plants with many varieties, but that people also transplant plants from the forest, which is a thing which they have done initially in the process of domestication, that is, of maintaining certain plants under forest cover. And this is why these plants progressively became domesticated. So what they do is they transplant plants from the forest, palm trees and fruit trees. And of course, when the Sweden, when the garden is abandoned after a few years of cultivation, perhaps 5 or 6 years, the transplanted plants from the forest survive the encroaching forest that regain the space, while the domesticated plants disappear. And when you think of this process in the long term, it means that the floristic composition of the forest is completely transformed, because there's a higher rate of plants that are useful to humans in the forest because of this process of transplantation. And so the Amazonian forest is not a virgin forest, it's a cultivated forest in many respects, no? Or it's the process, it's a result of a process of cultivation. And when we take these phenomena into account, then we have the first steps, as you said, with which to try and reconstruct historical, ecological evolution of the region, which is a co-evolution of humans and their environments over the millennia. Although the forms of the actual forms of collectives that we observe may be very different from those that were that can be reconstructed. I mentioned that yesterday, from the traces like this great earth mounds and pyramids that we, or urban, what look like urban settlements that we that are being found now in Amazonia. So the one has to take into account also that 90% of the native Amazonians were disappeared in one century. So it's mind-boggling. Imagine any country, modern country, being reduced to 10% of its population in a very short period of time, in fact. So the transformation, the collectives we see now are remnants of a Rome, which is hypothesized. Indeed, it's a Middle Age of which we do not know the Rome, as Lévi-Strauss very aptly said. Reconstructing the Rome will be a very difficult process, because again, the forms of collective that have survived have adopted very different ways surviving the encounter with the Europeans. In particular, it's well known that what are called now in the press, for instance, uncontacted tribes are not uncontacted tribes. They were people who have been subjected to the most atrocious violence during the rubber boom. They were enslaved, And of course, they are people who have fled and never to see a white person again. So they are, to use a bold image, like survivors of concentration camps that fled in the forest in order never to see the killers and the people who subjected them to the kind of forced labor and violence they experienced. This is this is well known for the recent past, that is for the rubber boom, but it must have been like that for a long time. And so the many of the institutions that we observe now have been transformed by this situation, since we have very little historical record in order that would allow to reconstruct this this past. So finally, you asked a difficult question. Why is naturalism the only way of worlding with a history? I think it's the invention of history by the naturalists was a great thing, which allowed the durability and the ability to expand that other ways of worlding perhaps do not have. And why did it happen once? I think it could have happened several times, but it didn't. It didn't work. It could have happened in the medieval Islam in the Near East. It could have happened in China. It could have happened even earlier in Europe. In Greece, there were elements there that were identical, but for a variety of reasons, it didn't work out. So it is an exception indeed, but an exception that could have, and also it's an exception that required something to appear. It required an analogous system before. Naturalism is a transformation of analogism, and not only because it is so historically, but also because of some logical reasons for it. Contrarily to Bachelard, for instance, I don't think that modern physics is a complete breakup with a physics of the senses or a physics of qualities, in the sense that the physics of qualities is based on the idea, on the analogist idea, that the world can be decomposed into elementary elements and that these elements can be combined in certain ways, that there's a regularity in this combination and in the outcome of the process that this combination produce. And this is, I think, a basis for modern physics or for mathematical physics in that sense. And you can't go from an animist physics, if you wish, one based on metamorphosis, to mathematical physics. But you can go from a physics of sensible qualities to a mathematical physics, because the basis are there, especially this idea of the elementary components of the world that can be organized and reorganized understood as having a regular behavior. I think I'll end up with this and continue the discussion with the audience.
Please.
please do continue the discussion in the course of the questions and answers. Jay, please wait until the roving microphone gets to you before speaking.
Okay. I guess I just want to go back to the question of rethinking our relations or to physical aspects of the milieu that we inhabit, and just try to understand better what some of the alternative conceptions would really come to. And I'm just picking up on some themes that came up in the second lecture and the discussion afterwards. I think Philippe made a very, to my mind, very apt comment about the kind of cartoonish way moral philosophers, and I belong to this tribe myself, but have accommodated animals, in their moral conceptions, which is a process of kind of letting them into the club in some ways by attributing to them, you know, qualities that we see in ourselves that we take to be the basis of moral standing in some sense. That's Peter Singer's, you know, expanded circle and so on. I think there is something kind of odd about that way of conceiving things. We just presume a sort of status to ourselves, and we bestow it on these other individuals by seeing them as like us in some ways. And that may be very well be, you know, I'm open to the idea that there are radical alternative ways of seeing things that don't, you know, that don't start from this questionable, framework and so on. But I was struck when it came to, we were talking about milieus yesterday and rivers, and we were talking about our relations to those things. Kind of the alternative frameworks that were offered seemed to me, sort of very similar to the processes of letting into the club that you were criticizing when it came to the animals. I mean, if to reconceive our relationship to the river is to bestow on it legal personhood, I mean, that really just seems like an example of taking a juridical concept that we apply to ourselves and allowing it application to new things that it didn't apply to before. It would be disappointing to me if that was the way we ended up reconceptualizing our relation to the river or to the milieu. Another thing that was mentioned in this context was that we might think of the milieu as owning itself, right? And maybe standing thereby in an ownership relationship to us. And I was also troubled by this because it was redolent to me of the naturalist kind of classic early modern Lockean conception of property, right? Which is a matter of appropriation through mixing one's labor. And it's the most absurd theory in the history of philosophy, to be honest, but it assumes that we stand in natural ownership relationships to ourselves, and then we extend this to the natural world through doing things with it. And I think we should just give it up, you know, even an application to our own relationship to the natural world. But if our transformed conception of milieu involves, you know, imputing to itself ownership, it seems like that's the wrong category. I would hope that the encounter with animism would open up something more interesting as a way of reconceptualizing the kind of relationship that we stand in here. And I'm sure that it does have such resources. So maybe I could invite you to say a little bit more about that.
It's an interesting question because it poses the shall I go there or
whichever you prefer?
Because it poses the question of what are the most the more efficient tools in order to change. No, if I mention this trend of giving legal personality to milieus, it's because precisely it's based on something which is familiar to us, in particular Lockean conception that because we own ourselves, we are in a position to exchange between human subjects, etc., etc. And at the same time, using it's in like Aikido, no, using the strength of something which is basic in our moral and political philosophy in order to transform it by completely perverting the notion of ownership precisely. and attributing ownership to something which on the face of it is not predisposed to being an owner of itself. Although there are cases, of course, the legal historians know that that the fact that things can own themselves and own other things is something that was common in the ancient world. For instance, temples being owners of land, etc., etc., or deity, in fact. So I think it's not an end in itself, but it's a means, and it's a means that can be that is useful in the sense that people can gather around an objective of this kind in a local struggle, for instance. No, if they instead of saying we want to protect this river against pollution, etc., uniting around the idea of the goal of transforming this river into a political subject, but it's only a small step further. But the consequences in terms of the conceptualization of property ownership are much wider. So I see that as a step, not as a general objective for transforming our ways of dealing with the world around us, but as a political step that is accessible and has already been achieved in some places. No? But I understand, yes, the idea. I've been discussing this with the last book I wrote with a friend called it's called Ethnographies of Worlds to Come, and we have had and it's precisely a book that is based on the idea that anthropology and archaeology provide stimulations for imagining different worlds, and the ways that indigenous people right now are fighting against the land grab to which they are submitted provides in the very that's why I tried to show yesterday in the lecture in the way they conceptualize their struggle. And in the way they try to adapt to the circumstances, interesting, stimulating ways of transforming our own political institutions. No.
Adom or Timothy or David, did you want to add anything?
No. Just a question more for you, Philippe. Does the person, or to you, Jay, as well, does the concept of person, I understand that it's primarily the motivation here is sort of a legal device that's being used. But then, of course, does it go farther than that? A person obviously has agency. A person affects other people and other actors and might have a personality, and a person could be good or bad or evil even. Was that ever in the cards there at all, you know, in thinking about it?
Legal scholars will tell you there's a huge difference between personhood and legal personality. And it's true. But at the same time, this does already exist in law. And since the law is the common language of our institutions, if we want to change them, it's important to subvert these legal concepts in order to transform our institutions. And this is why I'm quite interested in the process of legal personality being conferred to milieus. It doesn't mean the fact that I mentioned yesterday that in Amazonia, territories are sort of bodies, that relate to other bodies, neighboring territories. I don't know if there is any notion of personal in that respect, in the sense that I don't think these bodies are thought of as intentional agents, no? They are more like processes, vital processes that any organism will develop in order to sustain itself. And in that respect, I don't think there's any personhood implied. But I may be mistaken, I don't know.
Well, the Tibetans have a term for that. The Tibetans have a term for this. They call it drala. Or a drala is a sense of personality for a region or a milieu. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Philippe, I'm glad you brought up the ZAD, Notre Dame de Landes. I was there for the first anniversary of the defeat of the airport construction project, and it was an amazing like 3-day party with a lot of evidence of commodity fetishism being thrown under the bus. It makes me wonder, I mean, I like how you seem to be saying that there's a kind of a mutual exclusion or an antithesis between animism and commodity fetishism. And I've wondered about that, and it seems like there's a possible like mutual potentiation between the two. If you have struggles against commodity fetishism to protect land, animism could help those struggles along, and also, and they do have a whole cult of this like newt at the ZAD. They have this enormous puppet that took like 100 people to dance through the fields and all this. And there's a kind of a myth of that they identify with this newt there. Anyway, I'd love to hear if you have more thoughts on any of that.
Yeah. I think that new narratives are very important. We worlding is based in our education and socialization on narratives that we hear and that channel us in certain directions. And this is the case in any form of worlding, in particular in animism. So when you hear, I was mentioning that this morning in a seminar with graduate students in anthropology, when you hear stories of hunters in your childhood that describe in very precisely what happened during the hunt, the animals they've seen, the indexes that allowed them to infer that in some place it wasn't an animal but perhaps a spirit, etc. It renders an animist form of worlding obvious, and when you grow old, you will seize all these indexes as forms of interpretation of events in your life. So the question is, how do you do this purposefully? No, and there are people in the ZAD who are trying to invent new rituals precisely in order to create new narratives that would transform, that would accompany the institutional shift that the ZAD represents in terms of sharing property and sharing work and et cetera, et cetera. I think it's difficult, but it may be feasible. This is why images, rituals, narratives are an important part of this political process and should not be discarded. I think that it's not only image makers that make us feel that something different is emerging, but also narratives. I'm thinking of the great success of a writer like Richard Powers, for instance. And I think that it's the It's it's a consequence of the fact that so many people are discontent with the present situation, and they find in narratives like that a form of possible identification with the characters in a novel. And even if it doesn't mean mobilizing oneself in a specific struggle, it means at least sharing an empathy with the characters in a narrative. So I think this is very important, yes.
Yes.
Thank you. So I kind of have a very like specific question, but I want to ask everyone, but especially Philippe, can race as like we understand it today be understood only through naturalism as an effect of naturalism, and how conceptions of man becomes a means or a benchmark to measure other modes of being, whether it be being human and, yeah, that's my question.
I think so. I think that race is a product of naturalism, and we evoked this, Adam evoked this in a presentation. In particular, this obsession with scaling and marking hierarchical differences on the nature society scale. No, conceptions of humanity. This is an interesting thing. It's an interesting and puzzling and difficult thing, because we are all aware of the benefits that were the result of the philosophy of the Enlightenment and of the idea that there is a humanity and there's a human nature, and this human nature, which has been defined in very specific naturalist terms, is endowed with rights. And so we are not prepared to go to turn our back to that. But at the same time, as I mentioned yesterday about animism, humanity as a general concept is something very specific to naturalism. In an animist regime, there is no such notion as humanity as such. There are different tribe species, again, each with their specific habitat and dispositions, etc. And so the very difficult and tricky question is, how do we retain the benefits of the idea that humans have specific rights because of a specific human nature that has been defined in a specific, let's say, cultural form of worlding? How do we combine that with a more pluralistic approach of what humans and non-humans are? And this is an intellectual challenge, and that is one that we need. They will need them. When I mean we, all people who are interested in these things during this century will need to think out in order not to lose what was obtained, but go beyond based on different conceptions of humanity precisely. That notion of race for there are possible transpositions. In animism, there are different races of spirits. For instance, they are tribe species. They are not humans, but they are defined as races with specific physical dispositions and the forms of organization, etc. And even totemism in fact, the idea that your identity is derived from a prototype that left seeds of identity on the surface of the earth, and which means that you are you belong to a specific kind of being that is derived from these seeds of identity that includes humans and non-humans alike, is different, of course, from the notion of race as we know it, because it's hybrid. It implies humans and non-humans. But I think the general pattern is that they are different races. But the extraordinary thing about totemism is that in Australia, at least what is implied in totemism is that these different races must collaborate and in fact exchange spouses in order to produce new races, you know, in a way. So it's exactly the contrary of racism as we know it, you know. They are ontological differences that need, and these ontological differences are complementary and not exclusively of each other. Mm.
Did anyone else want to respond to that? No.
Going on to partially disagree, maybe. I'm quite convinced personally by the arguments of Cedric Robinson, for example, that race actually emerges out of feudalism in the sense of aristocratic bloodlines and is then transformed under capitalist labor regimes into something more like its modern biological form. But I say only partially disagree, because you just said earlier that naturalism must be a transformation of analogism, which would be compatible, I guess, with that, if I understand you correctly.
I was very struck by an article, I can't remember the author now, about a black person in Venezuela during the colonial period. And there was an incident. And so they described in detail the incident, but at no time in the judgment about this incident, it's mentioned that he is black. So it's only by circumstantial evidence that it was discovered that this person was black. And in spite of this, the obsession with the Spaniards had with the castas, no, that is with the distinction between racial distinctions with how they were the product of mixed marriage, etc. There were, I don't know, 54 castas or something like this. So there was a classificatory obsession at the time, but the classificatory obsession did not mean in particular that it had social or political consequences. Well, it had, of course, no, because the slaves were black, no, but engaging into an interaction, I think it was at church, could be described under many guises, but not as on the basis of his race. So it's. But you're probably right. I mean, there's a history of constitution. yes. But it was amplified, of course, immensely by the classificatory obsession. Well, the colonial Spain in Venezuela was very much still an analogous formation. They were not really, they were not much naturalist in that respect, no.
I mean, maybe just to add one other name I've invoked over the two responses would be Sylvia Winter, who maybe tells a slightly different story than Cedric Robinson. One, I think, you know, for her, this exactly the point you're making, Philippe, which is about the simultaneous revolution of and birth of something called humanity, which she does think is something to be celebrated, and the ways that came entangled with this hierarchicalization is the central problematic for her about trying to recuperate something called the human. But she thinks the first version of it in 1492 was about, you know, the difference wasn't biological race, not naturalism, but religion, right? And we talked about this, you know, the those who were not Christian, right? So for her, there's these various stages or transformations of the humanist project that I think corresponds to the story you're telling about the gradual triumph of naturalism. And one in which race over the course of that gradual triumph does become a biologized conception by the 19th century. So there's this, I don't know, important, I think, historicization or transformation of race that for her does always signal something like non-human, but what the terms of that non-humanity are shifting across this period of time. Mm-hmm.
Other questions?
I don't need it. I'll just
for the recording.
Just wanted, it is somewhat related to this, but it is not directly related to this question of race. I was also thinking of Sylvia Winter when we were talking about this, who's also influenced by Bateson,
yeah,
as you both are, right? So, but my question is on Islam, because you said in passing when you were like half an hour ago, like 20 minutes ago, that naturalism could have happened on the other side of the Mediterranean. It could have happened in the world of Islam. It could have happened in China. It didn't. And it happened in Europe. And I... because of your, you know, your the argument that the naturalism sort of transforms, but transforms is a complex word, right, for you. So it's not mechanical at all, the transformation. There is a radical alteration in the transformation. So maybe that is the answer. But from analogism, and this is an argument that even someone like Agamben makes, an infancy in history, for instance, when he talks about Neoplatonism and the development, the relationship of Neoplatonism and the development of modern science. And so the question of abstraction and the relationship of that to monotheism. And so I was wondering, because for instance, Levi-Strauss says in Race and History that Islam is actually a different case, because in the context of Islam, the place of nature was very different. It was much more inclusive of a different relationship to nature, and that the opposition nature-culture was not organized in the same way, he says, right? And I thought maybe you were thinking along those lines, but also at the same time, Islam is a monotheistic religion. I work, you know, in a Muslim collective, and to me, these things are kind of very complex, and I would not be able to simply say that because it is a monotheistic religion, then we have analogism, and therefore we don't have, you know, something like that. Could you say more about Islam, the way you were placing it within your arguments?
I think it's analogous in the sense that the of any analogous system that is the world is composed of many differences that need to be organized with systems of correspondence hierarchy, totalization, and monotheism, of course, is the great invention which allows this process of totalization in a very efficient way. But why did I say that in medieval Islam, in places like Damascus, for instance, naturalism could have emerged? Because there were a series of factors like differences in philosophical schools that were competing for gaining the attention not only of the learned but also of the powerful, much like in China also. Experimental science, in particular in optics. There were elements like that that it seems to me could have reorganized the specific configuration of relation between nature and culture in Islam towards something that is closer to what we know in Europe. I'm not a specialist of Islam, but it's a conjecture. And of course, the fact that there was a prohibition, at least in this part of the Near East, on images, is an interesting. I don't see the equivalent in Islamic images of this kind of prefiguration of something different, of a new form of worlding as we observe in 15th century painting in Europe. But I would need to be a specialist of medieval Islam to answer. So it's a pure hypothesis. No, I'm not prepared to defend it to death.
Let's continue discussion over food. But first, let's thank our four wonderful speakers.